watching Bloomberg Quint and you're tuned into The Fine Print. A bunch of taxpayers lost at the Supreme Court this week in a major litigation battle involving input tax credit refunds under GST. The cases came to the apex court after contrary rulings from the Gujarat and Madras High Courts. The issue relates to Section 54, which provides for refund of unutilized input tax credit. Now, this refund benefit is available to taxpayers if they've accumulated credit due to an inverted duty structure. That means when the rate of tax on inputs is higher than the rate of tax on output supplies. Now, the taxpayers argued before the Supreme Court that this refund of unutilized input tax credit must be made available for both input goods as well as input services. But the GST department opposed this approach, saying the legislative intent is to exclude services from the scope of such refunds. The Supreme Court agreed with the government's approach, saying any expansion of this relief by the judiciary is impermissible. To understand the implications of this ruling for businesses, I'm joined today by Ritesh Kanodia of Dhruva Advisors. Ritesh, welcome to The Fine Print. Ritesh, before we delve a little deeper into what the Supreme Court has said and why, can you help us with a little bit of a background on what businesses or what industries have this unutilized ITC problem because of inverted duty structure?
Yeah, so as the way the GST law is today, and I'm more talking in terms of the product rates. So we have product rates which are classified at 5%, 12%, and 18%, and then you have a highest bracket of tax. So the product rates which are at lower rate, which is 5 or 12, would have a situation where they buy goods, inputs, which are higher than 12% or 5%, because finished products and the raw material would obviously merit a different classification. In addition, they would also have input services, and most input services are today at 18%.
Yeah.
Now, if the margins are not adequate, what this could result in is that while you would be paying tax at a lower rate, which is obviously the intent of the government for such products, goods, they might be treating that as essential commodities, important aspects which needs to be kept at a lower rate. There are tax credits which get accrued in there. So, and this basically results in an accumulation between the output that you pay versus the input that you get, which is obviously higher because the higher rate of tax, which results in an accumulation. And the issue was whether that accumulation can be granted to them as a refund. Now, the provisions which were under challenge, which was Section 54, provided for refund for goods. And that was the entire dispute, whether...
Well, the definition uses the term input, which then the Supreme Court has directed the taxpayers to the definition of input, saying it specifies input to mean input goods. Okay. And there's...
Yes, the word used was input tax, and input tax was defined to mean input tax for both goods and services. That was Section 54. But then there was a proviso to Section 54 which speaks about certain eligible areas where you will get the refund. And the way the language of the proviso was, the issue which came up was, so it had 3-4 parts. One was export, so where you export goods and services, or zero rated supplies, you will get refund for both goods and services, GST paid on goods and services. The other part was inverted duty structure, and the way it was worded is to say that where the rate of tax on the rate of tax on input is higher than the rate of tax on output. Now, when you say where the rate of tax on input is higher than the rate of tax on output, whether is that a condition or is that a restriction? That was the key issue which was sort of deliberated to say that, look, if it is a condition, and once I meet that condition, entire thing is available as refund. That is what the SEC argued. On the other hand, department argued that this is not a condition. This is actually per se a restriction. And what it says is rate of tax on input. And the word input is defined to mean goods other than capital goods. And then there was the discussion about input versus inputs, etc. So the ultimate conclusion of the Supreme Court was to say that this is a restriction, and therefore the refund should be only restricted to inputs and not to input services.
Sure. I'll go back to my question, Ritesh. Can you help us understand which industries face this specific problem for, let's say, the viewers to get an estimate of what is the immediate impact of the ruling?
So, some of the examples which I can give you, so for example, EPC contracts. you know, where you carry out government projects, most of these government projects are liable at a concessional rate of 12%. Some could be even lower, where you pay a huge amount of input services. Right? Another example, now EPC contract typically is services. So, you know, the question was whether they could have claimed this inverted duty structure refund for input services. The other could be, let's say, the print media industry, where even newspapers are at 5%.
Yeah.
They would have huge amount of input services, which would be at 18%. So there is again a difference between the output and the input. And what you would only get is your raw material is paper, right? So let's say paper is at a higher rate. What you could only get is the refund for GST paid on paper. But what happens to the input services, which are at 18%? And there could be numerous such examples where every such instance where your product rate, so let's say hypothetically, and now I don't have the list of all the products, but let's say biscuits could be at a concession rate of 5%. The tariff rate is
any service, let's say that this biscuit company is sort of taking any credit that you, so basically let's say the biscuits, or let's say in this instance the taxpayer was a footwear company, which again I'm guessing is at 5%, right? So any services that these companies are taking, against those services, any tax that gets, or an input tax that's available, they will not be able to take the refund from the government against those services.
So what they will be eligible to refund is the raw material, the GST paid on imports. So for example, in footwear, they use leather, and leather is, let's say, at a higher rate. Or let's say any material which is at 12% or at 18%.
Yeah.
The government will only compare the tax paid at 5% on the output versus the tax paid on input, which is at a higher rate. Now, when you do the comparison, there are also input services which are taxed at a higher rate of tax. So you get refund for those. The issue was, I should also get that refund for input services. Why only input? Why there is a differentiation being created between inputs and input services?
Yeah.
Because if you look at the GST law, it's a goods and services tax, right? There has to be a harmonized structure for goods and services. There has to be a harmonized market for goods and services. 179A of the constitution provisions. So once you want a harmonized structure, where is the point of creating differentiation between goods at one place and services, because everything becomes fungible and is input credit. So the entire refund should be allowed. The government clearly, the Supreme Court clearly discarded this argument to say that there is clearly a difference between goods and services under the law. And, government has to make certain decisions considering, the socio-economic environment, the political scenario, etc., where different products could be at different rates, different refund could be granted in a scenario, not be granted in this scenario. So that is entirely the definition of policymakers. We cannot step into such policymaking avenues.
Sure, Ritesh. One way of reading it is to appreciate the restraint that the Supreme Court has shown in not sort of expanding the scope of economic policy, because in this case it just works out against or not for the benefit of the taxpayers. But I get that the Supreme Court has acknowledged that there are anomalies and has urged even the GST Council to reconsider its policy approach. We'll come to that in a bit, but this gap between some of the goods that are, let's say, in the 5% category, Ritesh, and given that on the other hand, most services are under 12 or 18%, there's a considerable gap between, or there could be significant, unutilized credits that a lot of companies would have currently on their books. Can you help us understand? So this ruling is coming after what, 5 years since GST got enforced? What has been the situation on ground? Have people sort of accounted that at some stage we will be able to claim for refunds? What has been the situation on grounds on this specific sort of refund?
So, what has happened is that people have made refund applications for both input and input services. So there is a time limit of 2 years to make a refund application. Now, while some would have done right from start, some would have done at a later stage for subsequent year, because you go year-wise on those refund applications. So all those refund applications which were made were pending. So people were granted refunds to the extent of inputs, but to the extent of services, those refunds were rejected. So on the ground, refund claims have been filed, have been pending, have been rejected, and most of these matters might have been put in a hold book pending the Supreme Court decision.
Okay. What changes immediately for some of the companies who have made these refund applications? Any immediate sort of changes that they need to do in how they are maybe claiming these credits or accounting rather for these credits on their books?
One immediate impact would be a question which would come up is that if you have accumulated credits now where you cannot claim a refund, and what they would look at is what is the future prospect of utilization. In fact, a question which would be asked by the statutory auditors to say that if you are not able to utilize the credit within a reasonable period of time, then you might have to create a provision in the books that triggers, you know, immediately impacts the profitability. Now, a question which would be debated between the companies and the auditors, because, you know, there is a provision, GST law is very clear that you can carry this forward indefinitely. But what auditor would also look at is what is the possibility of utilization of those credits.
Yeah,
that is one clear immediate impact where decisions will have to be taken. Another is, see, from a procurement perspective, if tomorrow comes, so one is credit can be carried forward unlimited, right? But let us say somebody might take a view that, look, what is the point for me carrying forward this credit? Let me just write it off to the P&L account and at least take an income tax benefit. So if the company is, you know, making profits and is paying 35% tax, so at least 35% tax benefit can be taken. Now, again, you know, that would really depend upon company to company and how do they look at it, because it's a 100% credit versus a 35% income tax benefit. And plus, you know, what would come up is the pressure from the auditors. So that is how companies would start looking at it. They would have created a receivable. Now there is a provision which has to be created against that receivable, because see, the decision is there, which is the you know, the law of the land. So there is, unless, you know, there is a different view which exists and it goes to a division, this is the final order.
And tell me, Ritesh, today, if let's say companies write this off and tomorrow, you know, government sees the reason in the taxpayers' arguments, or the council sees some reason, the taxpayers' arguments, that please give us this refund on account of input services as well. Can you in some way claim refunds? Because you, like you mentioned, it's for 2 years, and if, you know, I have accounted for that in my books, I've written them off. That benefit will then fall away if any sort of amendment comes in from the government or any relief from the government comes in, right?
No. So personally, I think any amendment in law, if it to happen, to my view, will happen prospectively. I don't think the government will grant such a huge benefit retrospectively, because it would be quite poetic to really, you know, look at once Supreme Court is in favor of the government, right?
Yeah.
It's a war that they won.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And if the government wanted to grant refund for input services, they would have done it long back.
Okay. Sure. Please. Sorry. Continue, Ritesh.
No. So clearly today's mindset is not to grant that refund of input services.
Yeah. Yeah. So the only option is for you to be optimistic and keep carrying forward maybe this on your books and try and reason with your statutory auditor that, you know, at in some sort of lovely day, if the government agrees to give us this benefit, hey, look, we'll have all of this to claim, versus a situation where maybe you're not able to convince the auditor and then you probably have to write this off and you take the income tax benefit like you pointed out. How will this?
So what happens is, even if you are not able to convince the officer, what gets created is only a provision. So you can carry forward in the GST book. So that doesn't impact your carry forward of credit. But the some down the line somewhere the question comes is that, is it a fictitious asset? You know, in the book, because the GST law, what is the possibility of utilization?
How can you explain to me the income tax benefit angle that you were just talking about? How would that work?
What happens is that you say write it off, you actually create a provision in the books.
Right.
There is a credit which is available as an asset. So the credit, when they applied for a refund, credit would have converted it to receivable. Now that's credit. So there is an asset. So you don't write off that asset. You create a provision against that asset, which impacts your profitability, but generally which is not allowed for income tax purposes. In many cases, there are certain conditionalities. So from a GST perspective, even if you make a provision, your asset remains, your credit remains. in the GST books.
But now the court has said that that benefit is not available. How will you show it as an asset?
No, so credit is available. Your receivable is gone, but the credit is available. So in terms of accounting, what happened? Okay, let me just slightly more explain you this. Is when you claim a refund, okay, you receive, reverse your credit, and then you show it as receivable from the government.
Sure, yes.
The refund is rejected, your credit gets reinstated.
Okay, yeah.
And from an auditor perspective, they will simply create another entry where they will nullify the credit from a balance sheet perspective. But from a legal perspective, their credit remains.
Okay, understood.
There is another thing where you do not create the provision, but you write it off completely in P&L. So you reverse the credit also completely.
Yeah.
That is where you get the income tax benefit of 35%. That is the options which are generally available.
Okay, all right. Coming to sort of why this situation came to be, you never had this benefit even prior to GST, right? On in the service tax regime, because refunds were always available, let's say in the VAT under the VAT law. So was this expectation, where did this expectation come from that we will be able to claim refunds on behalf or on account of input services as well?
See, you are absolutely right that in the pre-GST regime, the refund was allowed for goods and for VAT. But again, that was not restricted to rates. It was an open-ended refund, right? Whatever accumulation. Now, this expectation sort of came up is because, you know, when you merged your VAT and service tax laws, you created one law, one common law, goods and services, right? Now, once you've created one law, the expectation was that all the provisions that would apply to both goods and services commonly.
Yeah.
Right? Like, for example, for export, which was also there earlier, you were granting refund for goods as well as for services. So the idea was that if you have, and see, the idea of GST was, you know, a harmonized structure for goods and services, you know, across nation, and also make it completely fungible, and GST should not become a cost in the supply chain. Now, when you look at all of those parameters, the thought process was that, you know, such kind of GST should not become a cost in the chain. It should revert to you. That was the entire fundamental. And see, the point is that when both the laws are, everything is same for both goods and services, then why should the regulation be different? And that's where, you know, one of the arguments which were taken was Article 14, the doctrine of equivalence, to say that why are they treated as different? They should be treated as completely synonymous at least under the GST law. Now that argument,
I don't know, how are you reading the sort of Supreme Court's observation that they have acknowledged that, you know, the formula prescribed might result in certain inequities, and they have urged the GST Council to reconsider the formula. How optimistic are you, based on these Supreme Court observations, that the government will move in a direction that might be beneficial to some of the industries that fall in this inverted duty structure problem? But, you know, they're also taking a lot of services and have this unutilized credit against which they can't claim any refunds now.
Let me slightly step back. First, on one point of the ruling is on this doctrine of equivalence. I just wanted to make one point over there.
Sure.
I think what the Supreme Court acknowledged is that, you know, when you talk about this anomaly between goods and services, you may always not have an ideal taxation. Ideal tax law, right? Generally, an ideal tax law is a progressive tax law which is to be achieved. And one thing which clearly the government acknowledged is that when you are creating distinction between, you know, two classes, so we call it an intelligible differential, it's not necessary that you will always achieve, you know, an ideal GST.
Yeah.
An observation which was very clearly mentioned. Now, because of this challenge on Article 14 was rejected, doctrine of equivalence was rejected. Now, coming to the formula, what was pointed out was to say that if you see how the formula works, a particular person who avails both input and input services, right, and provides output. Now, at one side of the formula, where I am into the business of both supplying goods and supplying services, right? So my output tax will get generated from both goods and services. So on one side of the formula, you have goods and services. On the other side of the formula, what you are doing is you are removing services, right? And then you are deducting my out. So the way formula works is input minus output has to be a positive figure, because input has to be more, then you will get a refund. Now the tax that you are deducting is tax on input minus tax on input plus output.
Right.
So that said, that would result in anomaly for some taxpayers, because somebody who is not dealing in services, etc., extensively is getting benefited. The other point is that when you take credit, the credit becomes fungible, right?
Yeah.
So when I pay the tax, I paid from both goods and services, right? GST and goods and services. So why can't services be first utilized to pay the output, and the balance remaining should be deducted?
Yeah.
So what the Supreme Court observed is, look, both sides would be extreme, not deducting as well as fully deducting.
Yeah.
What the observation was, and what they said is, let government come to a mid path. Now, again, on that mid path, they came to a view that even just because the formula is not, supporting, doesn't mean I can declare a law as invalid.
Yeah.
So we cannot intervene. It's again policy. Please go back to the GST Council. They actually have strongly urged the GST Council to resolve this issue.
Okay. Any hope of this being sort of considered this Friday? The GST Council is meeting. Any representations that you've heard your clients or you want to make to the government on this, or given that how the government has litigated this all the way to the Supreme Court, chances of it are few and far in between.
See, this being picked up in the next GST Council meeting, which is sort of as early as I think 17th to 18th, is very unlikely, because the Supreme Court decision has just come.
Yeah.
Now, representations would be made, and there could be a possibility that the government may look at it, because the formula is actually logical in true sense. Now, there are multiple things which needs to be kept in mind, right? Because this would immediately result in enhancement of refunds across India.
Yeah.
And considering, the budget constraints, etc. Government can give this relief to the taxpayers, which is very clear. Now, whether they would want to do it right now, considering all the issues around numbers around GST, etc., that is, I think, the question which the government will have to think through. So I don't see anything happening immediately, at least not until the next budget. They are sort of mindful to say that yes, this is a logical ask and the formula should be tweaked.
Okay, all right. On that note, Ritesh, many thanks for joining us here on The Fine Print and explaining to us some of the consequences of the Supreme Court upholding the validity of a provision that has been litigated for several years now. Thank you for joining us here on Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you.